girls that are the same girl in parallel dimensions that discover that their worlds connect every 12 hours for exactly 1 minute at... Thank you. It's very self-explanatory. And because they're doppelgangers, they are exactly the same in their looks, and one girl's life seemingly has everything going perfectly, and our main character's life has everything absolutely going to hell. Of course they decide to switch places, because wouldn't you? And then that's where things go horribly, horribly wrong. And then our main character discovers that maybe everything she thought was so great about this world is not as great as it seemed, and then maybe she can't get home. So I had the idea driving home one night. Traffic in Los Angeles, as everyone knows who drove here tonight, is heinous, and I was like rushing to make the light, because if you don't make the light, then you gotta wait, because you're gonna miss the next one, and it's gonna be a nightmare. And I was going down Avenue of the Stars in Century City, probably going like 50 miles an hour to hit that green light, and turns yellow, and I'm like, brake, don't brake, be responsible, or just go for it. And I was responsible, and I hit the brakes, and then I was like, what if I hadn't? What if I gunned it? Like, how would my day be different? And then the story was sort of born from that, this idea that there are these two girls living the same life, but they're slightly different. And instead of it being like alternate realities, like a sliding doors type of thing, I decided to make them two completely distinct people who can then interact with each other. So you have two parallel casts of essentially the same people. And if I ever say I'm going to write a book like that again, somebody hit me. Because like, it's bad enough writing one cast of characters, but to write two of the same group of people, and then they have to all be slightly different, but not like polar opposites of each other. It can't be black and white every time. Sometimes they have to be just slightly different. It was really, really, really complicated and maybe slightly above my pay grade. So it was a difficult process writing this book. I think the first line of the acknowledgments really says it all. Some books practically write themselves, others are a struggle. 359 was the latter. So I feel very grateful that this book is even published, because there was a point in time when I was like, I'm burning it, I'm hitting delete, it's done, I hate it. But by the grace of a wonderful editor, it became something that I'm proud of. So that is 359, and now we will hear about Anti-Gods. Oh.
Yeah, we clap.
Hi, those of you in the back, I'm Nora Blake. I've got Anti-Goddess. Anti-Goddess is the first of a trilogy. The trilogy itself is called The Goddess War. I'm not terribly attached to that. I wasn't sure if it was going to hang on. I just wanted to use it as a placeholder, and now it's on the cover.
It's on the book. So
now it is The Goddess War. Anti-Goddess deals with Greek mythology. It draws a lot from the Iliad and the Odyssey, which I was a huge reader of when I was a kid, and to this day. I actually just got lines from the Iliad tattooed on my back, because I'm a freaking psycho. So in Anti-Goddess, the gods have lived with us just kind of since Olympus fell, since we stopped believing them. They've just kind of blended in and done their own thing. But now suddenly they're each dying their own specific horrific deaths. For instance, Athena, who is one of the heroines of the book, her sacred bird is the owl. So Athena, goddess of wisdom, goddess of justice, goddess of battle, sacred bird, the owl, she is being overtaken by feathers slowly, kind of like a cancer. They're just worming her way into her intestines, into her innards. Right now it's kind of localized in this region, you know, just like lungs and throat.
You
know, like
just the essential.
Working their way up, and sometimes she'll feel a quill in the roof of her mouth, and she'll have to wait a few days for it to pop the surface, and then she can rip it free. So, needless to say, this would really tick her off, and she finds that she's not the only god who's dying. All of the other Olympians are dying as well. So she sets off on a quest with her kid brother Hermes, god of thieves, and the messenger god, and discovers that instead of banding together to work together to save this you know, to save themselves and solve this problem, much in the fashion of Greek gods. They're morons, and they decided to start a war. So it's one god versus the other god, it's a set of gods versus a set of gods, and they're all descending, you know, to find out who is going to be the last god standing. Caught up in the middle of this, completely unfairly, is a girl in upstate New York who has a pretty good life, pretty good friends, lovely boyfriend. And what she doesn't know is that they're headed her way because they've received a tip that she's actually not just a girl in upstate New York, she's actually the reincarnation of Cassandra of Troy. And they think that she might be a weapon or she might have answers to what's happening to them. So that's the premise. They're all heading for her. It's going to be who's getting to her first. One side wants to use her and probably kill her. And the other side wants to still use her, but maybe not kill her.
Options.
Either way, you can be assured that her life is going to be ruined for the next three books.
just for like 1,000 pages. And then yeah.
It's kind of funny that 359 was such a problem for you, because Anti-Goddess was definitely a problem for me. I must have started this book and actually wrote it 3 or 4 different times, and they were completely scrapped drafts.
Wow. The writer in me just, like, cringed. I know how painful that is.
When I originally got the idea of dying goddesses, it just came to me as these images of each goddess's death, and I wrote them into a short story. And I thought, well, that's it. You know, that's my vignette about the dying goddesses, and it's over. And then I tried to write a book about Cassandra, because I love Cassandra. She's such a tragic figure. I've always wanted to work with her, and she does
She's
not
the
want
one
to
who,
work with me.
Who could foretell the future, but her curse would no one was believe her. Right.
Right.
Okay, I remember.
Frustrating, and then she gets an axe to the chest.
Yes.
I mean, it's just tough. Unfair.
And that was because she wouldn't sleep with someone, right? Did she get cursed for that, because she wouldn't sleep with someone?
Yeah. She said she was gonna, and then she decided not to. And I guess in the old days, you just couldn't change your mind. That was not a woman's prerogative.
Yeah.
You say you're gonna, you have to do it. So I tried to write this Cassandra book many, many times. I sent it off to agents. They said, oh, I'm so excited about the idea, but this book you wrote, it sucks. So all of them died. What am I doing wrong? So I ended up bringing Athena in to shoulder, you know, part of the burden. So Cassandra's story and Athena's story kind of ran concurrently, and it ended up, then it finally wrote itself in like 3 months.
Wow.
So I was missing the Athena quotient, I was missing the dying gods, and I was missing the fact that Cassandra did not want to be the star of the book. She'd, you know, been murdered many, many times, and she would much rather I just left her alone. And that's it.
Now, did you start writing this before Anna Dressed in Blood?
The Cassandra story I did, and then this actual novel, when it came together, I wrote in between Anna Dressed in Blood and Royal Nightmares.
Nice. So this was one of your first babies, in a way.
It was. And it made it nice, too, because I didn't have that, like, Anna Dressed in Blood separation anxiety.
Right.
Like, I knew that I was going to have Girl of Nightmares to spend with Kaz and Anna, so I didn't, you know, get all weepy.
I think it's a rarity in publishing where you get to revisit a book that didn't work out the first time and then actually have success with it. I think that's amazing for all of you with Trump novels, self included. I think that speaks to sort of perseverance and finding where the story worked, you know.
Yeah, I mean, if the story keeps nagging at you, chances are, I mean, it's there, you just haven't quite found it yet.
Right.
Well,
that's inspiring. So we can read from our books, we can do questions, we can do both.
I love how she said I can read from our books.
We were talking in the office beforehand about how neither of us read our books after we sort of send that final draft in when it gets to publishing. Like, neither of us have sat down and read the books. It's too painful for me to read them. I'm like, oh, I wish I could change. You mean I can't change it? It's already popped. What?
Especially with, I don't know, like, especially with this one. I could write this for the rest of
your life. Yeah. Well, you did. I mean, you wrote how many drafts of it?
Oh, so many.
I did almost a page one rewrite of 359.
Yeah.
After my first edit letter, so I feel your pain. My editor didn't actually request that I do a page one rewrite, but her notes were extensive. And it was that moment of like, I need to start afresh, at least partially, or I'm not going to be able to fix this book because I couldn't see it anymore. It was so jumbled, you know, too many ideas, I think, as well in the book. So that was painful.
Oh my God, it takes so much just to get to the final page of the first time. And then if you have to look at it and go, well, none of that's going to stay.
Yeah, and I hate writing first drafts. I'm that author that would much rather revise. I would rather, like, go into a fugue state and not remember writing the first draft. And then wake up and it's
spirit writing.
Spirit writing. Oh, it would be amazing. Oh, my God.
A big, huge novel of just like this.
It would be awesome. And then I can just fix it later. Like, that's my favorite part. But I have to write that damn draft first. It's not my favorite thing. It's painful. So, yeah. So, should we read?
Should we do a Q&A? Poll. Yeah. Q&A, show of hands. Just Q&A.
Q&A.
Oh,
there's a lot of tentative handwriting. Reading first and then Q&A.
Oh,
wow. A lot of people didn't vote.
A
lot of abstaining. So, why don't we just do Q&A?
I think both are an author's choice.
Yeah, last night I did an event and I didn't realize we were going to read, and I was with Melissa De La Cruz and her husband, because Frozen just came out, and they were like, oh, we'll read, and I was like, okay.
Let me find something to read.
I had no idea. It was slightly awkward. Okay, so then we'll do questions. And if questions are rewritten from your book, I'm going to stick my tongue out. I know, it's hard to break the